boy, oh boy, oh boy. Okay, here we go. My name is Timothy David Stark, and I am the sole and rightful owner of Superdeb.
Superdeb is Genner's humongous speaker that he really loves to death.
She is a speaker, but she's a big Jesus girl.
And she's a Proverbs 31 woman.
Mm-hmm. That is true.
Yes.
And it's Superdeb. 5 B's. I want to make that clear. People keep forgetting.
Superdeb is what we call, I'd say, Tim's Bluetooth girl.
Superdeb is a large, square, black speaker who has caused a lot more trouble than we could ever imagine of a speaker to cause.
I first met Superdeb a few months ago when my grandpa bought her from Costco, brought her home, although her name wasn't Super Deb at the time. But a couple months passed by and I had just lost my old Deb. She sadly died, and I was on the market for a new Deb. Now, my grandpa realized that Super Deb at the time was too heavy for him to carry around the house, and so he made a deal with me. He said, "Timbo, if you go buy me the new speaker from Costco, I will gladly trade you this big old speaker and you can take it to Big Sky Bible Camp." And I said, "Sure, Gramps. I love nothing more." I think that would be great, in fact.
And it was just connection at the first sight.
And I arrived the first night of orientation week with Superdeb, so proud, beaming with happiness that she was mine. I never could have imagined the pain that Superdeb was going to bring me.
I met her just about after I met Tim. We really kind of hit it off. We connected pretty quick.
I mean, she is quite something else.
I do know that there was some kind of issue between Gunner and Superdeb.
Someone, I don't know who, connected to Deb in the first place. Caden, it turns out, was the original person who connected with Superdeb in the first place that started this whole mess.
I thought it'd be so cool to just vibe to the speaker and play all my own music.
I witnessed the very first crime, and I listened as Sweet Caroline was playing.
Just could feel the bass and just vibe into it. I mean, just quite awesome.
I got back the next day and I was on dishes, and I brought Superdeb into the cafeteria, and I tried to connect to Superdeb, and when I turned her on, she said, "Connected." But she was not connected to me.
He was really unhappy about that.
Tim accused our whole table, lunch table that we were eating at. He was accusing us of see who Superdeb was connected to.
I started yelling, "Who is connected to Superdeb? Tell me now."
He was very blunt with the way that he accused us, and I felt very hurt by that.
I was so offended by this accusation that myself, Drew Cher, and Nacho Nathan decided that we were going to create a plot to kidnap Superdeb and demand a ransom.
The boys decided to play a slight prank on Timothy Stark.
The next thing I knew, Superdeb had been kidnapped from the dining hall.
We took her into the downstairs sunroom of the boys' dorm, tied her up, and placed a chicken toy next to her and sent him ransom pictures along with the text demanding $5,000.
I knew that one of the boys had to be responsible. I knew it. I just knew it. And so you better believe that I called all those boys into the chapel and we had a trial.
We were playing frisbee and then all the boys went into the chapel to have court.
Tim decides that we must take trials.
We had a great trial. Great time as friends.
It was chaos. It was hilarious. lot of accusations thrown around.
But I just remember seeing all the boys on the stage, Tim walking back and forth wearing a wig, and someone else at the stand wearing a cloak thing.
I interrogated every single one of them, looking for evidence.
And I was one of the main defendants being prosecuted, so since I knew who did it, I was just trying to play along and try to get Tim confused.
We're all just playing along, planning to reveal it pretty soon. I knew where it was at the moment, but was just watching most of all. More of a spectator in this unusual crime than anything else.
We heard rumors of another plot beginning to thicken.
It was me, Scrunchy, Bucket, and a couple others, a lot of like more camp kids.
We were seeing that the boys were getting very serious into their trial.
Then we thought it'd be like really funny if we went and we took the speaker whenever they didn't know about it.
The girls can't go into the boys' dorms, as we all know. That would be purpling.
We decided our options of who we could get involved in this. Zeke was the only boy around, but we knew that his conscience wouldn't allow him to go and steal Super Deb. So we resorted to Griffin.
Why do you hate Tim Stark?
I don't hate Tim Stark.
We got Griffin in on it and convinced him that he should join us and do our dirty work in stealing Super Deb.
I don't know why I decided to agree to this, but I did.
And we sent Zoom in, and he searched up and down and eventually found Super Deb. So we quickly ran over to the downstairs dining hall girls bathroom and hid him there. I was kind of suspicious of Zoom because he really wanted to know where it was.
I instantly felt remorse for what I had done, and after confirming that it was being taken to the downstairs dining hall, girls bathroom, I wrote a note.
And then as I'm out there, Griffin comes out, his little note, he's like, I don't know, like you know what to do or something. And so I did know what to do. I gave the note to Tim, which it was a little denotation of the location of Superdeb, or the supposed location, perhaps at that time.
Tim read the note, and he was actually sitting next to Cheyenne during Fireside, and Tim did not realize that Cheyenne was the enemy in this situation.
And the biggest mistake we make in this debacle is sending the girls to go get it.
And we sent the girls to go check on her. Girl said she wasn't there.
Tim the Thief was bringing the note around and interrogating people about who had written it, and Gipper, Reagan, he took the note and ate it, so that piece of evidence therefore ceased to exist.
I had a swallowed, like almost a chewed up note thrown at me during the trials. And we saw Nacho go from the chapel to the boys' dorm and back, and we're like, that's highly suspicious.
They thought that she was in the boys' dorm, and then she wasn't. So they were like running back and forth with terror on their faces as they realized that they had stolen Super Deb, but she had been stolen from right from another noses.
Nacho Nathan told me that it wasn't in the day room anymore.
I was thinking, oh no, what have I done?
At this point, I'm just assuming that it's all within the guys.
We quickly move Super Deb to the girls' dorm.
So I return to my cabin, thinking, well, that was fun. Maybe they'll find the speaker, maybe they won't. It doesn't really matter. And sitting in the day room, before my eyes, is this giant speaker.
We as girls had the speaker, Super Deb. She was sitting in all of her glory, kidnapped glory, on the table.
Super Deb was in the upstairs girls' dorm. And we were like, oh, we didn't participate, and we didn't realize it.
By this point, all the girls were in on it, and it was girls against boys.
We are chaining Deb up, we are threatening Deb with Clorox, and we are sending ominous texts. And at this point, I'm thrilled, because this means that the girls are in the place of power, and the boys are not.
We made a ransom note thing.
That's right,
like speaker.
We were there, though.
Yeah, and then we hid her under the bed.
That was really proud.
And then the next morning, yes, that was a good video.
We demand the following items on the floating dock by 6 p.m. on Friday the 9th. 2 Snickers, 2 Kit Kats, and a Twix. If our demands are not met, Super Deb will be sold on the black market. If our demands are met, then Super Deb will be returned by curfew on Friday night.
they had to write out a written agreement to call All Girls Week Woman Week for the rest of the summer.
Adeline wanted it to be all like Women Week instead of All Girls Week.
Oh yes.
And that's weird and I don't like it, so I didn't participate in that part.
And then something happened in the camp store. That's where my role comes into play. Reagan and a few of his henchmen ended up coming over, and they said they asked me to get Super Deb for them.
Reagan's deck was not on the same team as Gunner. In fact, he's just on his own team all the time because he's not going to be on a team with anyone else ever.
He had used the fact that the girls wanted to call All Girls Week Women's Week, which I believe that Women's Week sounds like a middle-aged ladies' retreat, and didn't really fully agree with that sentiment either. So that's really what convinced me to agree with the plan to bring Super Deb into the hands of Gipper. I carried it to the laundry room, and I placed it under some sheets. It was really quite well hidden, I think.
And then we return to go get Super Deb, and we realize that we have been bamboozled.
And I heard someone scream, "Super Deb is gone!"
One of the girls backstabbed us and stole Super Deb from under my bed and gave it to Gipper.
And Reagan was thoroughly confused. He kept texting me like, "Well, where is it?" And I would tell him it's hidden under the sheets in a pretty clear spot, but hidden, but a pretty clear spot for someone who was looking for it. And he was confused and I was confused, and then we realized a fourth party had come and taken Super Deb out because they had seen Reagan lurking around there, so they realized that Super Deb had to be in there.
I had done my laundry that morning, and then I had gotten some sheets out of the dryer to put my clothes in the dryer, and I like folded them and put them by the clean laundry and I stacked them up. And then when we went in, they were different. They were not in the place that I left them. And we moved them, and there was Debbbbb.
Super Debbbbb.
Super Debbbbb.
And so when we found it, the three of us went and looked at each other, and we're like, "We gotta hide it."
You picked it up.
Oh yeah.
And we carried it to Spotted Bear.
Reagan and I desperately tried to negotiate with them to try to get Super Deb back to us, and we could not do it. And so that was what we thought was going to be the end of the story.
And we were kind of like, we were kind of freaking out because it was in that Spotted Bear, like underneath one of the beds, and we had to sleep in there.
And then we get there, and I'm like, "Okay, Abby, you grab a broom and pretend like you're going to sweep the Spotted Bear. I'm going to clean the bathroom so it's not suspicious," even though it totally was. And she went in there, and she's like, "It's not there." So I'm like, "Okay, trade, so maybe I can find it."
It wasn't there. Because there's a lot of places to look in Spotted Bear.
So many.
She was gone. She disappeared out of Spotted Bear.
"We know that you put the ransom on the dock. We do not have Super Deb anymore. So we will still accept the candy. However, we don't have Deb anymore."
The next day we were getting random texts saying, "Nobody wins when you're playing my game." There was a picture of Super Deb in the dark in the bushes.
Most everyone was sent a random ominous text.
Actually, funny story, somebody here at camp has a one number difference from my mom's phone number. So randomly out of the blue, she actually received the text too. We're not sure how that happened. She had no idea what it was.
I remember one day coming into the dining hall and seeing Deb there.
Super Deb eventually shows back up in the dining hall, safe and sound.
It was just on the kitchen counter with a sign that said something like, "The end.
Game over.
Game over."
And after that, it ended.
You can only imagine the torture and the trauma that my heart has been through. But in hindsight, all I can say is I am just so happy that she and I are reunited and we're back together. I don't care who you are or how much you love the music that comes out of that speaker, stay away from my Super Deb, or you better believe that you're gonna have me to deal with.
I feel like Super Deb really was just She was just playing all of us, you know? Like, she had us all in her little grasp, and we were her playthings. And she was just manipulating us, really, to manipulate one another.
I think Super Deb is also a lot to blame for this. Like, I think Deb is short for, or is just short for devil. And so I think Super Devil is really her real name.
Every time I see her, I want to take her and hide her now.
I think the idea that something as simple as a speaker, if fueled by the right reasons, can lead to unbelievable, fantastic, somewhat macabre if you look at it through the speaker's eyes, results.
Timothy does have a much, much more, much stronger relationship with Super Deb than before this happened. I think it really worked to bond them.
If Super Deb is ever lost again, I want to believe that there would be more honesty and unity between the staff.
But I'm also very thankful for her espionages and her experiences as a kidnapped speaker, because I think it brought all of us as staff closer together. And we just had a lot of enjoyment for that first week. It's a strange thing to be brought over, but also it makes a whole lot of sense because it was a mystery story, basically a spy story. We all had our own parts to play, and it was very enjoyable.
But I think we thwarted her in the end. We're all closer friends because of it. She failed, ultimately.
Friendship is a lot like peeing your pants. Everybody else can see it. But only you can feel its warmth.
However, there is one element that only a few people know.
What I am wondering, and I still don't know, is who took it out from under the bed and spotted Bear?
My suspicion is Maverick, but unconfirmed.
I have a suspicion that it was you.
I still don't know the complete truth, and to be honest, I don't know if we ever will.
I know that Maverick had Super Deb at one point.
Did you do it?
No.
Thank you for your time.
Yes, sir.
Wait, who's Super Deb?
I thought it was Reagan.
It was you or Reagan?
That's what I thought.
It was reported that Sheila was suspicious.
So let me take you back to me and Reagan. We took one last look around the Outback to see if we could find it. As we were walking up to the Outback, we saw none other than Timothy Stark.
It was I, her sole and rightful owner, who found her in Spotted Bear.
He came to me and asked me if I could find it. I told him where to hide it. That's the truth.
I knew I couldn't do something that would divide the staff, but rather, I had to do something that would unify us. A scenario where nobody won. Nobody wins when you're playing my game. I was the one who hid Super Deb in the pantry. And I was the one who convinced Sheila to put Super Deb on the counter for everyone to see. Game over.
How does this action of yours affect Chick-fil-A's legacy?